when referring to the alkaline surfactant polymer, basically it also is my, also in my field. So, but introducing these kind of things into enhanced oil recovery is as a new thing, which is I have to get a new information, which is a petroleum engineering information, petroleum engineering subjects, incorporate in together. So we are going to have what we call it, information, theoretical, together with the applications. So we hope that my sharing this morning can give you overview about a new, what we call it, a new flooding, new cases. But basically, there is a lot of things happen during, I mean, operations, because there are a lot of things also, a new study, new things happen next years, next 5 years, next 10 years. But nowadays, they look at the ASP as a promising way how to increase the oil recovery from the old, what we call it, old reservoir. So I, as I said, my degree in chemical engineering, and I did my master's in polymer engineering and science, and also my PhD in polymer engineering. Then I'm working as a senior lecturer in UTM nowadays, and then almost 20 years joining UTM. Then if you're talking about my time in UTM, is very long. I've been here since 1993, so it's almost 28 years. Yeah, 28 years. So I've been doing so many things, projects in polymers. I've been doing with polymer, conductive polymer. But most probably next time we can also apply polymer conductive into enhanced oil recovery, because I look at that there is new method for enhanced oil recovery using electrical we call it electromagnetic field, electromagnetic applications for enhanced oil recovery. Okay, right. So let's look at to the guest lecture this morning can be mixed together with Bahasa and also English. Then I hope that you can learn some of the terminology or terms, okay, using English, because it's very difficult to be translated into Bahasa. So we need to remain it into English. Okay, done. Okay, so as you know, this is the overview of the enhanced oil recovery nowadays. So previously, our primary recovery.
Hello, Dr. Agus. Yeah. I think my student cannot see your slide.
Can see or cannot see?
Cannot see.
Cannot see my slide.
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
Minimize.
Let me. Can you see my slide?
Okay. Yeah.
Oh.
Sudah bisa. Sudah bisa. Ya.
Alright. Still sudah bisa?
Sudah bisa. Sudah.
Oh, right. So dia ada masalah sikit sebab saya pakai dua screen. Okay. Bila saya transfer ke screen sebelah, screen sebelah jadi blank. Yeah, anyway, so this is enhanced oil recovery overview. So previously we do the recovery using a primary recovery, which is natural flow. You know what happen if you bocorkan, impenetrate something into the high pressure, of course all the content in the high pressure things will come out, right, suddenly, which is we call it natural flow. We also can use artificial lift, meaning you can use pump to pump out all the content, all the oil from reservoir. This is already happened, but generally the percentage productions is less than 30%. So they move to the secondary recovery using water flooding. Basically, water flooding just to give some pushing to the oil, so give some energy to the oil, so the flow oil will easily come out from the reservoir. Okay, akan senang keluar daripada reservoir. Then also, of course, we are going to have pressure maintenance. Pressure maintenance also increase the pressure from the reservoir, also increase the pressure from outside. So we are trying to Basically, it looks like artificial leaf also. Now, but the enhanced the percentage of recovery just 30% to 50%. But generally, you know, everybody knows that generally now, the second, if you are still using a secondary recovery, the recovery can achieve only around 40%. So the remaining 60% or 50% of all still in the reservoir. So we need to do something, a new way or new methods to increase the production rate. So the introduction of a tertiary recovery, which is we can divide it into thermal, gas injections, chemical, and others. Which is thermal already discussed, you can use steam, but you know, when you use steam, the cost is very high, and then also you need to generate steam, you need to generate something that, but the problem is, if you have a steam, the viscosity of steam is lower comparing compared with the oil. But you know, oil is the high viscosity, it's very difficult to flow. So if steam also can have a little bit, the hot water also can have a little bit, combustion also can have a little bit, but energy is driven by energy, and the cost of energy also very expensive. So they move to the another things which we call it gas injections. Okay, they introduce carbon dioxide because we have carbon dioxide. The climate change happened, you know, the amount of carbon dioxide in our environment is keep increasing every year. So utilizing the amount of carbon dioxide will help you to reduce, to help you to sustain our earth, meaning that we are trying to help our earth to be in good conditions. Then also introduce hydrocarbon, nitrogen, flue. But nowadays the chemical, which is chemical flooding, we have alkaline, we have surfactant, we have a polymer. Then we hope that using this kind of chemical flooding can increase the percentage to up to 80%. Then we can't clean everything, oil in the reservoir. There is a still remaining 20%, but it's okay. At least 80% already be recovered. Okay, but I'm not going to discuss about microbial, acoustic, and electromagnetic because I also share something information just now about that things in my introductions. Okay. For now, I hope everybody knows, because I believe the first lecture, the first guest lecture already introduced this kind of things. Then we are just moving to the next introductions. Okay, this is, what is the purpose? You need to understand the purpose of water flooding. The purpose of water flooding, enhancing or recovery after primary method. previously, we use what we call it artificial lift, using palm, for example, using something that compressor, for example, to fill lift up all the oil when there's the remaining oil or the oil in the reservoir. So they also increasing the bottom pressure of the reservoir. This is water flooding. The function of water flooding. So now, because of water flooding, water. The viscosity of water still lower than oil, so the successful rate pushing our oil from reservoir still lower. So introducing a polymer flooding, so because polymer itself can increase the the viscosity of water. To certain viscosity, then give a push to oil. Okay, so we are trying to what you call it mobility ratio, to achieve the mobility ratio which is less than one, for example. But it's not possible to do that because some of the mobility ratio are still higher. So the possibility of all the oils will come out from the reservoir still not really convincing. So whatever things is minimizing water mobility, then increasing sweep performance. If you're talking about sweep performance, it's something like you are trying to detach oil, detach oil or try to, because oil now, detach meaning that melekat dekat rock, dekat batuan. So using polymer, you are trying to sapu. This is what we call it increasing sweep performance. Eh, sapu ataupun clean, try to clean. This is related to interfacial tensions of oil and water. But previously, the interfacial tensions between oil and rock is very high. So you are using polymer, you are trying to reducing the interfacial tensions. So interfacial, you know what is the interfacial tensions? Interfacial tension, the ability of the some material to form interactions, additions between them in the surface, in the face to face. So we call it interfacial tensions. Dan ada juga yang kita boleh katakan, we can understand on oil itself. So ini ada perbandingan bila kita tengok, bila kita bincang pasal interfacial tension, because in we talking about in the chemistry point of view, kita akan cerita berkaitan dengan the what we call it, the equivalent point where the polymer, the material will attract to the surface of rock or surface or something. So if the attraction is quite high, so meaning that is that volume, that materials is very difficult to be detached from that surface. So polymer itself, originally oil dekat batuan dalam poros. So we are intends to introduce polymer flooding because we are trying to increase the sweep performance. At least we are kind of to achieve the mobility ratio. So only the polymer will, only the oil will flow out from the reservoir, so the polymer itself can push all the oil flow out. So that's the for introducing the polymer flooding, basically to enhance the performance compared to water flooding. Okay, so because polymer itself is not enough, it's not enough to push, it's not enough to give push for oil to come out from the reservoir. So we introduce alkaline surfactant together with the polymer. So these three materials, we put it together, yeah? So decreasing further the interfacial tension between the oil and water solutions. Yeah, polymer itself can decrease interfacial tensions. But introducing a specific material which is alkali. Why so alkali so special? Why surfactant so special? This is the question you need to ask yourself. You need to ask what is the specific properties of alkaline? What is the specific properties of surfactant to make this ASP is very special for enhanced oil recovery? Okay, for tertiary enhanced or for enhanced oil recovery. So the purpose is decreasing further interfacial tension between oil and water solutions. So meaning that if you introduce ASP, then ASP will increase the sweep performance, meaning that they will detach, they akan menanggalkan minyak-minyak di dari permukaan batuan, dan kemudian dari lepas tu minyak-minyak ni akan terapung-apung. This is the function of surfactant. Alkali basically dia akan sweep. Dia akan tanggalkan. You know, tanggal ya, pisahkan. Okay. Then at the same time, alkali introduce in order to reduce the absorption of chemicals. Surfactant is very expensive. Surfactant is very expensive. So kalau tidak ada alkali, surfactant akan penetrate dalam poros batuan, dan itu akan tertinggal di dalam poros batuan. So ini akan mengurangkan keberkesanan surfactant for the next flow. So introducing the SP, introducing the alkali will help to reducing the absorption of the surfactant at the rock surface, then improve oil recovery. Okay. So some people, they are trying to to improve the ASP usage in on oil recovery by introducing nano fluid flooding, which is the introducing what we call it nano metal oxide. Okay, the alumina oxide, ferrum oxide, silica oxide, as silicon oxide, okay, then titanium oxide, all these kind of material can be introduced into polymer basically to increase the viscosity of polymer itself. So this is another thing, so enhance or recovery due to further decrease in IFT. They are trying to decrease further IFT, interfacial tension between oil and surface of the rock, right? Surface of the rock. So oil nanti akan terpisah daripada permukaan, akan mudah sebab selama berjuta-juta tahun minyak ini memang melekat, melekat kuat dengan permukaan batuan. So kita perlukan specific materials yang akan menanggalkan ataupun akan memisahkan. They introducing aluminium, alumina, introducing or metal oxide. This is nanoparticle will enhance or recovery dan juga akan menurunkan lagi IFT interfacial tensions between oil dan juga rock surface, dan akan menyebabkan rock surface nanti dia akan more attract to the water. So kita tukar daripada oil wettability kepada water wettability. So this is related to the rock surface lah. So incorporating nano size particles for some metal oxides, as I said, there is a lot of study about using these nanoparticles. Okay, this is the overview. Now what happened in the research of enhanced oil recovery. So we move from the primary, we move to the secondary, we move to the tertiary. Now in the tertiary, we move from thermal, we move to the gas, we move to the chemicals. Now we move to the something that microbial, something that electromagnetic field and something like that. But in ASP itself, there's still a lot of things to need to be learned. A lot of things still unexplored. So kita kena explore because we have a hundred of alkaline type, we have a hundred of surfactant type, we have hundred of polymer, but you have to look at the polymer itself. Polymer itu macam gel. If you look at to the starch, kanji for example, kanji lah. Kanji bila you dilute into water, for example dalam hot water, dia akan jadi gel kan. Macam you sekarang kalau kita buka puasa, kita akan ada sagu. For example, sagu juga also you can attract the polymer from sago. Dan kita panggil kat sini sago lah.
Sago.
So kita boleh extract polymer daripada sago, dan this polymer can also be applied into enhanced oil recovery. Dia punya key point di sini adalah to increase the viscosity of water, to give extra push to the oil, after this oil being detached from rock surface. Itu dia punya apa, functions of polymer. So we still have meaning that options lah, options, natural resources kita boleh gunakan. Macam saya introduce tadi, we can extract from cassava, we can extract it from purple yam, we can also extract from ladies finger, something like that. Apa dipanggil, kacang bendi ya? Kacang bendi. You can extract the polymer from kacang bendi. You can also extract the polymer also from lidah buaya.
Lidah buaya.
Yeah. Semua itu apabila kita letak dalam air, dia akan menjadi gel. Meaning that bila dia jadi gel, viscosity increase from certain value to up certain value. But now kita kena buat satu kajian supaya viscosity, we achieve the certain viscosity, which is that viscosity will have to give extra push to the oil to easily or flow out from reservoir. So you know the viscosity oil is quite high. So you need to understand how we are to understand viscosity, the terminology of viscosity, the terminology of IFT, what is the IFT interfacial tensions. So I hope that you already be introduced what is the definition of interfacial tensions, what is the definitions of certain things lah. Okay, this is questions you need to ask yourself. What is the alkaline? And then what is the characteristics? Alkaline, of course, is opposite to acid. Alkaline, the pH numbers is from 14 to before 7, isn't it? Alkaline. We have so many types of alkaline. Okay, we have a nitrogen oxide, hydroxide, we have calcium carbon dioxide, something like that. So these are the things, bila kita dilute this alkali into water, the alkali will separate into charge, ion charge. Okay? Ion charge, a positive charge and negative charge. Same thing happened to the acid, but we introduce alkaline, not acid, into reservoir because the content of reservoir itself is acidic conditions, but some of the acidic conditions. So alkali will neutralize it, so the oil will easily be detached ataupun dia akan terpisah mudah daripada batuan. So this is the alkaline. Then the purpose of alkaline I will introduce more later on. So what is the surfactant? Surfactant ini adalah chemical which is dia akan ada dipanggil hydrophobic dan juga hydrophilic. Hydrophobic ini kalau dikata phobic kan, phobia. Hydrophobia meaning that dia tak suka dengan water. Dia tak suka dengan air. Itu sebab kita panggil hydrophobic. Okay? So material yang ada keupayaan hydrophobic, dia tidak akan bercampur dengan air. Tidak akan mudah larut dalam air. So apabila kita campurkan juga dia, you akan tengok dia seolah-olah terpisah dalam campuran. Okay? Itu yang bila kita campur minyak dengan water, kita akan tengok minyak akan terapung-apung di permukaan water ataupun sedikit dalam water, which is hydrophobic. Then another one we call it hydrophilic. Hydrophilic adalah kecenderungannya untuk bergabung dengan air. Maka di sini kecenderungan sebab dia ada charge. Sebab kita tahu air itu dia ada charge juga kan, oksigen dan OH kan, H2O. H plus dengan OH. So apabila ada charge, so yang negatif akan ada kecenderungan kepada positif, positif akan kecenderungan pada negatif. Ini yang berlaku dalam air. Okay, ini yang berlaku dalam air. Jadi this is surfactant. So surfactant basically to once you apply into reservoir, you akan pecahkan component of water itu, component of oil into small, dan akan lebih mudah nanti dia akan masuk dekat porosity. So increase permeability of rock. So increase permeability dia. Apa dia permeability adalah boleh upayaan untuk minyak melepasi batuan pada lubang-lubang kecil, which is we can call it as a capillary, lubang-lubang kecil. It's very very tiny hole which is kita boleh, maknanya kita pun tak nampak sangat sebab ini hanya berlaku dalam batuan bawah tanah. This is the function of surfactant. So now what is the function of polymers? Apa dia polymers? Polymers ini adalah daripada bahan simple, bahan ringkas yang diulang berkali-kali di masa proses tindak balas kimianya dan menghasilkan polimer. Dalam tindak balas menghasilkan polimer. Jadi polimer ini banyak-banyak benda dia. Jadi polimer juga dihasilkan daripada minyak. Polimer also can be extract from natural resources. Like I said just now from cassava starch, purple yam, from lettuce fingers, from any kind of things that they can be. If you dissolve in water, they become a gel, which is a good candidate for polymer floodings. Okay, so improve UR basically give an extra push to the oil, so oil will easily flow out from the reservoir. So because nowadays we are trying to use different kind of method just to give extra push to the oil to flow out from the reservoir. So introducing alkaline surfactant polymers flooding, dia bukan datang sekali, meaning that bukannya datang tiba-tiba alkaline surfactant polymers together in one piece, one package. No, the researchers study one by one. The researchers study from alkaline flooding first. They look at that what happen if they're introducing alkaline flooding into reservoir. So bila introducing alkaline flooding into reservoir, dia okay, yang ini berjaya, tetapi dia tak boleh kepada carbonate, dia ada carbonate stone, sebab carbonate stone dia akan ada acidic yang tinggi dan menyebabkan kita perlukan alkaline lagi banyak. So dia perlukan pada yang sandstone. Sandstone dia punya dia ada acidic rendah dan salinity dia rendah, jadi ini akan membantu alkaline. So kalau tak, dia akan bertindak balas dan menyebabkan effectiveness of alkaline akan berkurangan. Which is this study have been done several years ago, dan dia tengok bahawa alkaline itself alone cannot be improve much on enhance or recovery. So that's why they introducing surfactant. But before introducing surfactant together with alkaline, they need to the study about surfactant flooding first. So they look at that surfactant flooding, introducing surfactant into the reservoir, and they dapat menyebabkan oil itself detach ataupun terpisah daripada permukaan batuan, dan akhirnya dia boleh boleh mengalir ataupun dia boleh mengalir melalui poros-poros batuan. Tetapi ini juga tidak membantu disebabkan kerana surfactant itself can easily be absorbed, maksudnya mudah untuk diserap masuk dalam batuan, kerana batuan sendiri itu ada poros tadi yang, jadi kalau sudah minyak dikeluarkan, so surfactant akan mengganti tempatnya. So bila mengganti tempatnya, surfactant, jumlah surfactant akan sentiasa berkurangan. Ini akan meningkatkan kos ketika berlakunya surfactant flooding. Dan kita tahu surfactant is very expensive. Surfactant ini nowadays is very difficult to find from natural resources. Yang ada kita panggil sebagai synthetic surfactant. So nowadays mungkin kita akan datang, mungkin dia akan cari, akan dapat natural resources surfactant. Jadi I hope that everyone of you can have some kind of motivations to find out, to find what is the natural resources to produce a surfactant to replace the expensive surfactant. Okay, if you find these things, you boleh buat, maknanya you akan berjaya lah. Sebab setakat petroleum engineers, chemical engineers, geologists, they still lagi namanya clean surfactant polymer. Now they study polymers just to give a extra push to the oil, extra push to increase the water viscosity, right? So to reduce the mobility ratio, so that help, right? All remaining oil in the reservoir akan keluar bersama-sama dengan water, bersama-sama dengan yang lain. So tetapi ini juga menyebabkan bahawa masih tidak cukup, kerana the increasing of enhanced recovery percentage production rate still not enough. We have still remaining oil, still much remaining oil in the reservoir. So introducing, now previously they introduced alkaline surfactant, now then kemudian introducing alkaline polymers, then kemudian introducing alkaline surfactant polymer flooding. This is the structure, how we come out with the alkaline surfactant polymers. Combinations between alkaline, three different things. Three different purposes, to improve the production rate of oil from reservoir. Okay, so again, the figures on our left basically referring to the timeline, the utilizations of ASP flooding, okay, and also look we can differentiate between this type of flooding in terms of our oil recovery factor. Of course nowadays ASP successful to increase the production rate, enhance our recovery factor to the maximum stage, but this need more to the natural flow, to the water flooding, then of course every stage has to be every stage already past the optimization conditions. What is the definitions of optimizations? Optimization basically to find out what is the component composition, the right composition which is can give you the maximum enhanced recovery factor we can achieve. Okay, Jadi dia polymer flooding juga sudah melalui fasa dipanggil optimizations. Now ASP flooding, we need to face, we need to go to for fasa optimizations, but still under cost under study because we still many options on the type of agglomerates that we can use. We are trying to introduce polymer, synthetic polymer to the natural polymers. Kita extract polymers from anywhere, from our plants, from our what we call it vegetable, for example, saya katakan sawah starch, kita boleh extract polymers from petroleum, kita boleh extract polymers, dan juga polymers which is cellulose. Polymer salah satu lagi cellulose. You tahu cellulose itu boleh kita dapat daripada kapas. Kita cellulose juga kita boleh dapat daripada empty fruit bunch. Cellulose itu adalah polymer yang ada di dalam tumbuh-tumbuhan. Okay, it depends. Macam cellulose kaya banyak di dalam kelapa sawit. So terutamanya dia punya selepas kelapa sawit itu, biji kelapa sawit sudah diambil, diproses, dikeluarkan minyaknya. Jadi remaining we call it empty fruit bunch. I don't know what's the definitions in bahasa empty fruit bunch. Apa dalam bahasa ya? Rizal? Rifan?
Like crude palm oil, no?
It's a crude palm oil. Palm oil. Bila you dah detach, you dah keluarkan semua biji-biji kelapa sawit yang tinggal itu. Apa tu panggil? Kelapa sawit yang tinggal tu. Macam contohnya kalau kelapa. Ya, bulan puasa ni orang pakai kelapa kan? Ambil air kelapa kan? So kelapa tu yang tinggal tu, itu dipanggil sebagai, kalau di sini dipanggil M2 Pro Bunch dalam bahasa Inggeris. Tak tahu dalam bahasa Melayu. Tapi orang selalunya dia akan dibuang lah. Dibuang dekat kawasan kelapa sawit. Dan mereka tak guna apa-apa lagi. Dia tak terus buang. Tapi sebenarnya benda tu kita boleh extract. Cellulose. Which is cellulose yang adalah polymer. Cellulose ini juga bila bila kita dilute dalam solvent, dalam water for example, dia juga akan membentuk gel, which is a small gel yang akan increase the viscosity of water. This is polymer flooding. There's still a lot of options lah. Kita boleh dapatkan natural resources of polymers. So, ASP, now, again, how ASP functions? How ASP functions? ASP, okay, again, the surfactant reduces interfacial tension between oil and water. Contoh, sebab kalau oil and water, dia susah untuk bercampur. Kalau you tak percaya, you still do not believe me, okay? You pergi dapur nanti, you ambil minyak masak, palm oil, cooking oil, you campur dengan water, dan you tengok. Dia tak akan bercampur. Of course, oil, cooking oil, basically dia punya density. So that's why you akan tengok oil akan terapung-apung di permukaan air. So this, kalau dia bercampur, you akan dapat macam sugar with water. You takkan nampak sugar itu ada berbarunya terapung-apung di dalam air. This is kita kan katakan bercampur. Tapi dan satu terminologi untuk kita katakan bercampur ini adalah miscibility or compatibility. Miscibility, two chemicals can blend together dan kita tidak boleh tengok perbezaan dari segi fasanya. Tetapi oil dengan water ini dia still lagi, sebab kita tahu oil viscosity is quite high, even though the density is lower than water, tapi dia punya viscosity quite high. Dan water basically adalah dia punya density 1000 kilogram per meter cube, tetapi dia punya viscosity is quite lower. Okay, so apa yang kita nak buat? Sebab bila water mengalir, kalau viscosity water dia rendah, viscosity water rendah, minyak tidak akan ikut. Minyak akan tertinggal di belakang. Surfactant, dia punya fungsi surfactant adalah untuk mencampurkan minyak dengan air itu supaya menjadi satu. Tapi of course, minyak dengan air tetap tidak akan dapat bercampur 100%. Tak boleh. Sebab minyak, it has a certain chemical properties which is cannot be. Sebab minyak sendiri adalah hydrophobic. So hydrophobic, Tak boleh. Jadi surfactant ini yang ada hydrophobic, yang hydrophilic, dia akan membantu supaya minyak dengan air ini akan bercampur. Apa yang dia buat? Dia pecahkan minyak dari segi partikel besar dalam grup yang besar, dipecahkan jadi kecil. So hydrophobic akan melekat dekat oil, hydrophilic dia akan melekat dekat water. Basically surfactant will come as a bridge, jembatan antara oil dan juga water. Oil dengan water. Tapi before dia minyak ni akan terkeluar, apa ni, tercabut, terpisah dari batuan, kita kena introduce alkaline first. Alkaline. Dia introduce alkaline supaya dia terpisah, dan kemudian surfactant akan mengapung-apungkan dia dalam water. Dan kemudian bila kita introduce polymer, so dia akan senang mengalir keluar. Okay, this is the functions of surfactant, which helps mobilizing oil that would normally remain trapped in the formation rock. Okay, trapped dalam formation rock. So if this is surfactant functions. Now, what is the alkaline purposes? Alkaline purposes serves two purposes. First, to reduce the absorptions of the expensive surfactant in the formations. So because of, as I said, surfactant is very expensive. So if you still using surfactant without introducing alkali, you will losing surfactant. Okay, surfactant will remain in the reservoir. Okay, remain in the reservoir. Jadi effectiveness of surfactant to make it oil and water together, sejati tidak bagus. So after injections into the formations, alkali reacts with the reservoir rock, increases its negative charge that leads the reduction of surfactant absorptions. So ini juga akan menyebabkan alkali ini dia akan attach kepada permukaan batuan, dan akhirnya surfactant akan terkeluar dari permukaan batuan. Itu alkali punya functions. The second function is the hydrolysis of naturally occurring acids in the crude oil to form of surfactant in the reservoir. What is the hydrolysis? Okay, alkali with acids basically both of them will react together, will react each other, react, bertindak balas antara satu sama lain, akan menyebabkan what we call it sebagai form bubbles. Okay, form additional volumes of surfactant in the reservoir. So sama rasa sama, dia akan menyebabkan minyak ni akan trap into bubble create by tindak balas kimia antara alkali dan juga batuan tadi, atau yang batuan yang ada acidic conditions. Okay, alkali serves two purposes. Okay, now we move to the polymer. Polymer is added to injected chemical mixture to increase its viscosity, which improves the sweep of crude mobilized by the surfactant. Okay, any questions so far? Any questions? Just ask me if you have any questions. You can ask me in bahasa, you can ask me in English.
Okay, dear student, kalau ada yang belum jelas, boleh ditanyakan dulu.
Ya, kalau tidak ada yang kurang jelas, boleh tanyakan, saya boleh translate dalam bahasa, dan kemudian kita boleh teruskan kepada yang lain. How long, Mr. Rifal? Our guest lecture, 1 hour, 2 hours?
Actually, in 11:20 in Malaysia time, doctor.
11:20.
But if you, it is you up know, to you.
My slides, already finished 6 of 28 slides.
so if you can finish it, is better, doctor.
All right. Okay. I'll try to finish it as early as possible. Yeah, I mean before 11:20.
Yeah. Lesson time.
Any questions?
Not yet, doctor. We can continue.
Don't be shy. Jangan malu, tanya saja. Yeah. Saya tak nampak pun wajah masing-masing. You can ask me. Kalau you punya kamera masih on, you ambil kain, tutup muka bertanya. Nobody knows. Betul. Kita hanya berkomunikasi menggunakan suara sahaja. Yeah.
Okay, ngadak ni, adik-adik sekalian. Ini belum jelas.
Okay. Jelas introduction of ASP. So you know the function of alkaline, you know the function of surfactant, you know the function of polymer. Okay? But you before understanding that this the function of these chemicals materials, okay? You have to know what is the specific, I mean, what is the what actually is alkaline? What is the alkaline? You know acid dengan alkaline kan? Alkaline. So, dalam Indonesian words dia panggil apa alkaline? Alkaline juga kan?
Yes, still alkaline.
Still alkaline. Ya, yeah, alkaline. So alkaline you boleh jumpa, boleh dapat di dapur kan? Dapur, kita juga ada acid di dapur. Okay, so kita boleh kalau belajar nanti kalau kena nak tahu berkenaan alkaline, just ambil acid, maknanya R5 ke, ambil limau nipis ke, campur dengan alkaline. Kalau ada berlaku tindak balas, maksudnya itu adalah alkaline. Eh, contoh macam alkaline yang kita gunakan adalah you punya ubat gigi ataupun toothpaste kan, ubat gigi. This is alkaline. Tapi alkaline yang tak high pH lah. Kalau high pH, this is corrosive. So low pH. Okay. So okay, baik. These comparisons between
excuse me, enhanced doctor.
Yeah.
You said it is a low pH. You mean like a base basa, not acid.
Yeah.
Because low than 7, it's acid.
In the acid alkali conditions from 7 to 14.
Yes,
so I mean when I said about lower pH, meaning lower, it's not less than 7. Not less than 7. I'm sorry to confuse you. Anyway, so look at here, this is to compare percent recovery stage, recovery percentage, four different floodings, which is water flooding, polymer flooding, surfactant polymer flooding, then now we are introducing ASP flooding. If you can see the green line, show us which is ASP flooding, meaning give us higher percentage enhanced oil recovery. So, but this higher percentage is not there, it's not just there. You can increase a little, you can increase again by introducing any type of surfactant. But nowadays we try to find what is the cheapest alkaline, cheapest surfactant, and cheapest polymers, which is the our options sources basically is a natural resources. Okay, so now again, chemical injection UR. Now we move to the case study. Now I already introduced several informations about the ASP. So largely because of high cost, tertiary chemical injections methods are not used as much because of high cost. You know, introducing three different polymers, three different chemicals itself, you increase the cost expansion. Right? Cost expansion meaning that the budget lah kan, production belanjawan ataupun kita panggil sebagai perbelanjaan. So increase
budget friendly.
That's why tertiary. Sorry.
No.
Tertiary chemical injection method.
Correctly, it's a budget friendly.
Hello.
Muhammad Ali. You have
yes, Muhammad Ali.
Ada pertanyaan apa
buat? Any questions for Muhammad Ali? Please shoot.
Ngejelasin aja sih bukan pertanyaan.
Oh, just making clear, dokter. Okay, dokter, we can go.
Yeah, clear statement.
Okay.
Yeah,
Terima kasih banyak. Okay, so that's why they're introducing another EOR methods. So, for less percent of all UR methods used in the US is chemical injections, less than 1%. Mungkin sebab di sana dia punya sumber alamnya kurang, tetapi di Indonesia, di Riau for example, sumber alam terlalu banyak. So you ada, kita ada kelapa sawit, which is you can extract cellulose from your kelapa sawit. You can extract cassava starch, producing nanoparticle cassava starch from your cassava. And then you can also planting what we call purple yam. Purple yam orang dah, kalau dulu orang guna untuk makan, dia makan purple yam. Purple yam, keledek, yes. Keledek purple kan? Dan kita ada dua jenis keledek, satu purple, satu lagi yang putih.
Putih.
Dua-dua pun boleh. Tapi so far yang purple tu dia punya content of polymers higher than yang putih. Yang putih kurang sikit. That's why kalau kita sudah masak yang putih tu dia nampak macam brittle. You know brittle, dia rapuh. Rapuh tu maknanya mudah pecah lah berbanding dengan yang purple yam. Purple yam ni dia nampak macam melekat. So that's why bila melekat mungkin kandungan kanji dia tinggi. Bila kandungan kanji tinggi itu adalah potential candidates untuk extract polymer. Okay. So a proposed UR project may not viable for economic reasons. But nowadays I think probably some people they talk about UR project may not viable for economic reasons. Meaning that tak sesuai, tidak bagus disebabkan kerana it's very expensive. Ini berlaku bila harga minyak rendah. But nowadays harga minyak semakin stabil. Bila semakin stabil, keep increasing to 50 USD per barrel, isn't it? Nowadays. So that's why di bahasa yang sama kita juga boleh cari ada alternatif. Ini kita boleh cari natural resources. So of course there's a myriad of factors, variables must be taken into account. There's so many factors, alkaline sources, surfactant sources, polymer sources, lower alkaline instead of using a stronger alkaline, I mean weak alkaline, stronger alkaline, because weak alkaline you can extract from plant also, you can make from plants kan, kita boleh dapatkan as banyak lah surfactant for example juga. So also drilling new wells for chemical injection project instead of using existing well may not be cost effective. So kita gunakan untuk drilling new wells dan kemudian kita gunakan chemical injection project instead of using existing wells, tak begitu bagus. That's why chemical injection in UR still a long way to go. Kita ada banyak lagi option, kita ada banyak cara lagi untuk cari. So dia masih banyak lagi, masih banyak lagi option, masih banyak perkara yang kita boleh buat. Okay, and now I'm going to introduce more technical things, more technical informations. I just introduced just now without this picture. Okay, surfactant is a system. In a system with water and oil, a surfactant will reduce the interfacial tension between two liquid phases, which liberates. Which yang seperti saya katakan adalah memisahkan. Memisahkan residual oil held by capillary forces. Memisahkan minyak tu daripada permukaan, daripada capillary. Okay, capillary reduction, capillary pressure in the reservoir, leaving in waterway. So dia akan daripada the oil weight, the waterway. So pada minyak yang melekat dari permukaan akan bertukar menjadi air yang melekat dekat permukaan, menggantikan tempat minyak tadi. Dan akhirnya dan kemudian minyak ini dan kemudian akan dipecah-pecahkan menjadi partikel-partikel kecil. Yang saya katakan partikel-partikel kecil. Jadi easily be mobilized and produced. Okay. So a surfactant molecules made up of water soluble and water insoluble hydrophobic component. Sebenarnya surfactant ini kena ada dua compositions yang saya kata hydrophilic dan hydrophobic. The hydrophilic dia akan kecenderungannya untuk bergabung bersama dengan water. Hydrophobic dia akan kecenderungan bergabung bersama. Dipanggil tu amyl. Sini adalah macam air yang di mana dia akan attack mana-mana yang akan menyebabkan mana-mana yang dia rasa dia akan tarik lah. Itu yang berlaku dekat surfactant. Okay, so again I just repeat the same thing which is I already introduced in the background just now. Okay, reduce interfacial tensions. So just to change the wettability alterations from all weight to water weight, and then you mobilize the residual oil. Can be introduced polymers or colloid dispersion gels or brine water. Can be used along the surfactants when mobility controls is necessary, which is if you want to improve, to increase the mobility control, the mobility of oil, you need to introduce together with a polymer, colloid dispersion gels or brine water. Brine water ini macam salinity, dia ada kandungan salinity tertentu, most probably around 100,000 ppm of salinity content lah. So ini dia punya a big picture how surfactant works. Surfactant breaks up the surface. So in this case, surfactant akan masuk, jadi dia akan break up this surface. Jadi menyebabkan oil nanti akan terpisah dari permukaan dan menyebabkan oil akan lebih mudah keluar daripada setiap poros ataupun setiap capillary. Dan polymer itself akan push every particle oil keluar daripada porosity. So this polymer itself also increase the permeability of rock ataupun batuan. So resulting in smaller droplets that are easily flushed out from the porous sandstone. This increases oil recovery from reservoirs. So surfactant also increase the wettability of the porous sandstone surface, facilitating oil release. Inilah dia, facilitating oil release. Okay, when you are, this is the control, this is particle oil, okay, in water. So once you introduce surfactant, only 0.1%, there will be, the reactions between surfactant with oil. You look at the oil particles is integrate into small particles. Dia daripada yang besar ini, dia menjadi particle-particle kecil, which is senang, mudah untuk dia mengalir. Okay. This also happens. Okay, then this is the another one. Oil itself is very high viscosity, but lower density compared to water. The once you introduce the surfactant, okay, there are bubbles because of the reactions between surfactant with oil. Dan akhirnya oil tadi yang daripada sebesar-besar ini dia menjadi partikel-partikel kecil and mudah untuk dia dikeluarkan daripada reservoir. Okay, so this is oil from 6,700 cps set poise into oil viscosity 200 cps. So this another functions of surfactants. So what you call it? They can form what yang kita panggil sebagai pseudo emulsions. What is a pseudo emulsions? Emulsion meaning kita mengapung-apungkan polymer dalam partikel yang kecil di dalam air, dalam water. Macam ini kita polymer ni terapung di permukaan dalam satu partikel yang besar. Dan of course ini susah untuk keluar. Macam tadi saya bincang dengan Mr. Rifal, dalam keadaan suhu bilik, air itu memang tak senang dia akan mengalir. So it's very difficult to from one box to another box, or one bottle to another bottles. Okay, so alkali methods, again I will repeat the same thing, which is reducing the absorption of surfactant on the reservoir rock, form in situ surfactant to lower IFP, meaning that alkali itself can react, boleh bertindak balas dengan acid conditions on the reservoir to form surfactant. Dan juga apabila dia form surfactant, of course dia akan reduce the IFP. So alkaline makes the reservoir rock more water weight. Macam tadi juga, di samping surfactant akan juga memisahkan antara oil dengan permukaan batuan, tetapi alkali juga akan bertindak perkara yang sama. So that's why alkali introduced, because relatively inexpensive. Okay, Softened injection water is required in ASP. Very low concentration of divalent cations such as calcium plus 2 and magnesium plus 2. Otherwise, these cations react with alkali agent and form precipitate, which could plug the pores of more reservoirs. Then kalau higher injection water, meaning the salinity is quite high. The salinity quite high, jadi dia akan menyebabkan tindak balas akan berlaku dan akan membentuk what we call it calcium carbonate, for example. Magnesium oxide, for example. Calcium carbonate, magnesium oxide, basically all this material, dia tidak akan mudah bercampur dengan water, tidak akan mudah dilute, tidak akan senang dilute dengan air, menyebabkan dia akan terpisah, membentuk satu bahan kimia baru di dalam reservoir yang akan menutup poros dan akan menghalang aliran minyak. Ini kita, jadi dia kata kita perlu soften injection water. A higher salinity of the water phase can also be undesirable. It can decrease the solubility of surfactant molecules in the water, in a sense that alkali usually caustic soda. Kalau higher salinity, but I was told that Sumatra punya salinity is quite lower. Even though kita dah check hari tu pun, kita dah ada water daripada SPR Langgak punya sample, dan kita check dia punya salinity is quite lower. Kalau tak silap saya 100 ppm. Jadi kalau 100 ppm kita boleh minum. Boleh minumlah, rasalah juga ada sikit-sikit kan. Okay, so jadi kita tak perlukan very specific alkali. Just a weak alkali, I think is enough to be applied into SPR Langgak reservoir. Okay, this is another end, role of alkaline. Okay, then kita akan ada organic alkali dan juga kita ada conventional alkali. It's up to you to find what is the organic alkali dan juga conventional alkali. The organic alkali can be compatible with polymer, can compatible with hard water and surfactants. No softening required, which is kita tak perlu reduce the salinity content of water kalau kita nak introduce organic alkali. So kita boleh terus apply organic alkali dan kita boleh terus inject kepada reservoir. Moderately high pH obtainable, which is the pH around, for example, mungkin around 10 to 15, 10 to 15, 10 to 15, 10 to 11, not more than around up to close to 14 lah, 14 dia tinggi kan. So sodium salt of certain weak polymer acids. So organic ini adalah salah satu kita panggil sebagai organic alkali dan dia boleh bertindak balas dengan weak polymer acids. But in comparison with conventional alkali, you can have a corrosion problems. This is scale problems. Scale meaning that you have to dilute the conventional alkali into certain pH before injecting into reservoir. So we can have also lowers polymer activities. So conventional alkali will lowers the polymer activities. Conventional alkali will also have precipitates in hard water. What is it precipitates? Dia akan produce material baru yang akan menyebabkan plak ataupun menutup poros-poros batuan. Again, softening usually required. Kita perlukan menurunkan pH dia, menurunkan itu, dan high pH obtainable. Ini adalah contoh-contoh. In my case, student saya akan buat dua alkali. Satu alkali weak alkali dan satu lagi adalah strong alkali. Dan kita akan lihat perbandingan antara keduanya dan kita akan lihat efek pada reservoir di SPR Langgak. Okay. So what is a polymer? Polymer basically function is, I would like to introduce you polymer because kita mungkin tak tahu lagi, kita belum ada experience. Okay? So kalau boleh kita nak macam ni. The blue color basically is a polymer solutions. Jadi kita nak polymer dia akan increase surface contact dengan oil. Ini mungkin kawasan ni adalah oil. Jadi kita bila increase surface contact, dia akan mudah untuk push minyak tu akan mengalir ke depan. Okay, so this is the mobility ratio is 0.151. This mobility ratio 1, this mobility ratio 2.4, this mobility ratio. Tapi without polymer, kita akan dapat mobility ratio yang cukup tinggi, yang di mana water akan hanya memasuki kawasan-kawasan tertentu. Let's say ini minyak, dia akan dia penetrate into certain area on the oil. Jadi kita tak, dia tak akan push kepada oil, meaning that oil tidak akan mudah mengalirlah. So kita nak, so usually kalau kita introduce ASP, we hope that mobility ratio must be less than 10. Less than 10. Jadi kalau kat sini yang paling yang ada ini 17. Ini okey. Jadi dia still ada surface contact ini akan lebih mananya lebih tinggi, dan dia akan mudah untuk apa dipanggil memberikan pressure kepada oil untuk keluar daripada reservoir. So again, polymer, this is example of polymer. I hope I have 3 minutes more to before we end the sessions. So this is a type of synthetic polymers. I hope that I will share this slide to you later on once we finish and completed this guest lecture. So this is natural polymers. So you can extract another one. You can extract another polymers from any natural sources. Okay. Okay, the compositions of ASP is not much. Okay, you look at this, the surfactant composition in water, just 0.1-0.3%. This is the range. So we need to have a specific research, which is to find out what is the optimum compositions. Di antara 0.1 hingga 0.3, kita kena cari mana dia punya composition yang paling bagus. Di antara 0.6 hingga 1.4, kita kena cari mana composition di tengah-tengah yang paling bagus. Okay, it depends on the conditions of SPR langka. The polymer itself around 0.1%. But if you increase a little bit, about 0.11%, 0.1%, you increase the viscosity, it's very difficult to the polymer itself to flow into the porous or porous of rock surface. Kita juga boleh gunakan brine. Brine ini adalah salinity water, which is can help to dilute all this chemical into water. Okay, again, another one. Okay, this is another one. Examples. I can show you what is the functions of ASP. Okay, so this is the originally oil trap in capillary. So by introducing alkaline surfactant solutions, you are trying to reduce the formations of it's not formations, the size of oil to small size, dan dia akan senang lah untuk mengalir dalam poros. Okay, so terusnya ini adalah saya tunjukkan. Ini yang berlaku dekat dalam maknanya dalam operations nanti. Kita inject kat sini. Pertama kita akan inject ASP dulu, alkaline surfactant polymer to separate our oil between the rock surface. Okay, then kemudian kita inject polymer untuk move pushing to minyak ni sekali jalan untuk keluar, dan kemudian baru kita inject water sekali lagi. Jadi kita adakan 3 fasa. Pada injection ini boleh kita sekali injections, ataupun kita boleh juga different injection, we call it slug lah. ASP can be inject in one slug or 3 different slug, which is kita boleh inject alkali dulu ke surfactant, kemudian polymers, ataupun kita boleh inject alkaline surfactant dulu, ataupun alkaline surfactant polymers, ataupun alkaline polymers or surfactant polymers. Depends our arrangement. Okay, depends. We need further study on that to confirm which arrangements is suitable for that conditions. So about the challenge, because this is more what we call it, too technical. So that's all. I completely end my guest lecture 11:20. Pass to Mr. Rifal.
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you very much to Dr. Agus for presenting about alkaline surfactant polymer fundamentals and replication.
Any questions?
Yes. So, adik-adik mahasiswa sekalian, yuk, gak apa-apa pakai bahasa Indonesia juga, gak apa-apa.
Ya, bisa.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Tadi pagi ya, saya sendiri lah. Saya Muhammad Alif dari
perkenalan nama dulu Ali.
Bapak Ali ya.
Ali dari ya dari kelas D di sini mau bertanya sih. And I'm gonna ask you a question. Maybe so, English.
Sure.
According to your slide number 26, if I remember correctly.
Number 26.
Yes.
This one?
Yes. So, based on your saying that this polymer in HB can be adjustable, right?
Yeah.
But the water can be adjusted, right?
Which one? Water? The blue color?
And water. Yeah.
Blue color?
Water one cannot be adjusted. Cannot be adjustable, right?
Okay. You mean that which one adjustable? Okay, ASP basically is adjustable.
Okay, polymer.
Yeah, polymer also is adjustable. Water,
but water.
Water, huh? you just add water, another water flooding behind the polymer flooding. You understand what I mean? Faham maksud dia? Saya maksudkan adalah pertama sebelum kita mulakan productions. This is oil bank, which is all, everything is oil, for example. Everything's oil. Everything first, oil. So what we are going to do first, we inject ASP. We inject ASP with certain compositions. Okay, certain compositions, it depends lah. You can inject the ASP differently, 3 slugs or 1 slug or 1 inject, 2 slugs, it depends. So there's still need further study on that. So once you inject the ASP, then later on you inject polymer. This is ASP flooding, then also polymer flooding. The final one, if you inject another one, we call it water flooding.
Oh, okay. Yep. So it depends on the rock, right?
Yes, of course.
Depends on the layers.
Yeah, of course. Depends on rock, depends on layers, depends on sometimes water salinity water also need to be adjustable. Okay, depends, because we don't want to disrupt, meaning that to disturb the polymer effectiveness, the ASP effectiveness as well. Okay, still need further study on that.
Oh, okay, I got it.
Okay, so, thank you, Ali. Thank you, Ali.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you Muhammad Ali. Terima kasih.
Ada lagi? Soalannya berapa minit, Mr. Rifal?
Is it okay with your time, Doctor? We receive another
I'm
question.
Okay. I'm okay.
Okay, adik-adik yuk. Udah ada materi yang sebelum dikasihnya tuh kan? Materi yang dari Abang. Hmm.
Sudah ada maklumat berkenaan dengan SP.
Yes, Doctor. Yeah. Ada paper juga. Ya, enggak apa-apa. Yuk, 90 orang nih.
90 orang.
Ya, sebentar. Masa enggak ada yang bertanya?
Ada yang bertanya.
Baru satu orang nih.
Alhamdulillah nasib baik ada satu orang. Kalau tidak ada tidak orang, Mr. Rival kena bertanya. So we still have plenty of time.
Yes.
5 minutes to go to 11:30. So if you have any questions, I think most probably all of you understood well, yeah? Understood well about the explanations.
No one? Nggak ada deh.
Okay, tak. Tidak mengapa. Tidak mengapa kalau tak ada soalan.
They are very.
It's okay.
Saya, doktor, maybe they are malu-malu.
Yeah, malu-malu. They shy. No problem. Kita pun sama juga. Saya juga sama masa belajar pun sama shy juga. Tapi ada sesekali saya tanya soalan juga lah. It's okay. So, but because of this petroleum engineering, it's not just this reservoir enhanced oil recovery. It's not just a local, how we call it, local activity. It's an international activity. So everyone will be looking to work with EOR. Once you're successful doing EOR, introducing a new method of EOR, introducing new component composition of EOR, meaning introducing new type of alkaline, new type of surfactant, new type of polymers, then also you're introducing new methods of ASP. You will successful doing your job, you doing your research. These are the things, because nowadays it's very difficult to find a new well or new reservoir. Yeah, it's difficult. Sebab kalau ada pun, it's very costly, kan, betul kan?
Yes.
So by utilizing oil reservoir, I mean remaining reservoir, was good advantage to us, especially. Tetapi saya faham Sumatera masih banyak lagi minyak, belum explore. Walaupun dulu company seperti Chevron, ConocoPhillips, Shell, Shell ada tak ada di Indonesia?
Shell, yeah, we have to.
Di Riau.
No.
Ada juga.
No.
Tak ada.
I'm not sure.
Tapi Chevron ada. Chevron. ConocoPhillips ada kan? Tak ada juga. Sumatera, area Sumatera. Tapi tak apa, mereka dah gunakan yang pakai normal.